What's up, guys? Here with Dino Cazares of Fear Factory. Dino, it's great to see you live in the flesh. How the hell has quarantine been for you?
This COVID year has been a pretty busy year for me, actually. Been doing a lot of stuff for Fear Factory.
It's amazing to have a new Fear Factory album on the way after 6 years. It's just a fantastic record filled with so many things that we love about the band over the last 30 years of innovation. I do want to clear up some stuff, though, because, you know, in the media or public standpoint, this release has been a bit turbulent, you know.
Yeah.
And
some of our best records have been pretty turbulent. Demanufacture was not an easy record to make. I mean, it was easy to write, get the band together and write these great songs. But when it came to recording process, it was pretty brutal.
Of course, that's been the nature of the band and possibly the reason that, you know, you guys write such killer records, you know.
Yeah, I can be pretty, when it comes to stress, I handle it pretty well and I can work well under stress. You know what I mean? And trust me, there's a lot of things that go in my life that could be pretty stressful. Everything from, guitar, fighting with producers, trying to get guitar tones, demanufacture to, obviously the turbulent relationships between me and band members and things like that. You know, I'm not going to deny anything or hide anything because that's just the nature of relationships.
Yeah.
You know, it's ups and downs, you know?
And, you know, I've always appreciated that you've always been a very upfront and honest guy, you know, as far as like, if something's bothering you just say it, you know? And I think that's kind of rare in metal, you know, where everybody's trying to like walk on eggshells and not piss off the next person, you know?
Well, some of the reasons why band members don't want to do that is because they don't want to get sued by another band member for a defamation of character and so on, you know, but I pretty much don't, you know, I wear my emotions on my sleeve, you know, and of course the media likes it because, you know, they can make a good headline out of it. Right. But for me, it's just, that's who I am. And I've always tried to be straightforward and honest with people.
That said, I do want to clear up some stuff because, you know, as I said, this has been a kind of a weird one for sure. Now, we started hearing rumors about this album back in 2016, where you hope to have this release out in 2017. A couple of years later, Burton mentioned the album title would be Monolith and coming soon, which of course didn't happen. And then of course there's, you know, the whole legal issues surrounding previous members holding things up. So I wanted to ask, is Aggression Continuum that album that we've been hearing about for the last 5 or 6 years, or was that original, you know, album kind of scrapped and reworked?
It was not scrapped or reworked, but it is the album that you've been hearing about since 2016 or 2017, really. But after all the legal turmoil that we went through and, you know, the trademark name being held up in court, and we were not sure if this record was going to be called the Fear Factory record, you know, we thought that maybe we should change the name, excuse me. And of course the label didn't want that, and plus so we stood it out to the bitter end, you know what I mean? And back in 2020, July 2020 was when I was able to regain the rights to the trademark, that I decided that, hey, the record's been sitting there since 2017, right? I decided that it needed some much improvements, some elements that I felt that was lacking in the first version of it. One of the main things, of course, was we had programmed drums on the first version. And I thought, hey, you know, we got this amazing drummer, Mike Keller, who's been with the band since 9.5 years. And I was like, well, we need to get him on the record. We need to put him on the record. This needs live drums. And of course, adding Mike Keller on the record made a big difference because it actually brought some energy and some life into the record that maybe you might not hear it, but I hear it. And I felt that it definitely, you know, what you're hearing, like Disruptor, you know, it definitely gave it more power, which I was very excited about. Plus, you know, we wanted to get Andy Sneap back on the record because he mixed Genexus. And then that was the first time I ever worked with Andy Sneap. And he did such an amazing job in Genexus. I wanted to bring him back. And so he mixed the record. Also, producer Damien Reynaud, who has worked with us since The Industrialist. He's been working with the band in one way or another, you know, engineering or co-producing or helping producers, blah, blah, blah. So I wanted to give him the driver's seat this time and have him, you know, produce a record with me. And came out amazing. Of course, we had to get Reese Fulber back on the record, right? So we got him on a couple of tracks and numerous of other keyboard players that we got on the album as well. And I thought that it was, I think the end product was definitely a much needed improvement that was going to benefit everybody. Fans, you know, myself and especially Burton is definitely going to benefit all of us to put out a fucking amazing record. And I think that, you know, everybody's going to like it.
Yeah. I mean, I can vouch for that. I've heard it. It is truly amazing. Like I said, it's kind of like what you love about Fear Factory and a whole lot more. You know, having Mike Heller is an amazing drummer, and I think you made the right move there, you know, because he does add a lot of amazing elements to it.
He's a fellow East Coaster, Mike Heller. We got him out here in California now. We got him out here. We took him from you guys.
You stole him. Now, you know, as you said, that this is the album that we've been hearing about since 2017. That would place, you know, at least most of this album created shortly after the 25th anniversary tours of Demanufacture, which was just fucking amazing. You know, I've been watching you guys since the original album came back out in 95, you know, playing places like Tramps in New York City. And, you know, it's just amazing to relive that energy live. You know, with a lot more people in the room this time. And that said, revisiting Demanufacture so intensely over that amount of time, did it have any effect in writing, you know, for the process of Aggression Continuum?
I want to say that everything that I've done in the past, you know, is definitely something that I can always revisit if I need to. I definitely always want to try to improve every record that I do, every new record. You know, you want to like try to take it a next step. Of course, right? But sometimes, you know, you kind of go back to where you started and you don't want to forget that, you know, and I don't want to forget that because some of the most classic things I've written were in the past, you know, years ago. And if I ever get into any kind of a writing stump or like maybe like a structure of a song, sometimes I'll go back and say, hey, what did I do back then? You know, and I'll go back and revisit something that I might've done and maybe I could apply it to a new structure of a new song, right? And so like, okay, you know, this worked. I could, you know, if it worked back then, why can't it work now? So, you know, sometimes you can do that. And that's one of the beauties about having such a huge catalog.
Yeah, absolutely. And actually, now that you say that, it comes to mind that, you know, some of the songs I think you used on Demanufacture were like leftover bits and pieces that you had from previous work that...
I mean, we had probably like 25 songs written, but we put 17 songs on the first album, Soul of the Machine. That's a lot of songs.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and so mainly you would see that on punk bands, right? That maybe only wrote 2 minute songs, 2.5 minute songs. They could put that many songs on the record, right? But our songs were like, you know, regular time, you know, like 3.5 minutes to 5 minutes. And putting 17 songs on a record was a lot. We actually kind of learned our lesson. Like it was too many songs on a record that, sure, there's a lot there for people to listen to and get into, but in a record sequence, it was just a lot. And sometimes, you know, people can lose the attention span because it's so long, right? So we learned that lesson. So we went in to do Demanufacture. We concentrated on the 10 to 11 best songs. And that's the reason why that record came out so solid and so perfect as it was.
Yeah, then of course, you know, you can have extras for like Japanese releases and whatnot, you know. So
correct. And that, yeah, those were actually the B-sides. You're right, that's the B-sides from, you know, leftover demo tracks. Like Concrete was on there. And then if you go into Obsolete, there's a bunch of B-sides that we did, and like 2 or 3 songs were left over from the demo tracks and stuff like that. And even Mechanized, when I came back, even Mechanized, there was like we redid some of the old songs as well. And like some of those are going to be re-released when we, now that we've done, we did a licensing deal with Nuclear Blast to re-release some of those old albums, and Mechanized is one of those records, and it's going to have some bonus tracks of stuff that we hadn't released before. So there's a lot of stuff to look forward to in Fear Factory.
Seemingly, I know it's been 6 years, but you guys are always, or you are always at work, you know, and working on something for sure. And, you know, I bring that up, that, you know, the whole demanufacture thing and possible influence on it, because I do hear, even though, you know, like the old classic, like those brutal fucking rhythms and melodies and everything like that, I do hear elements, new elements, you know, on the record. For instance, a very different style of orchestration through the songs, you know, like, although mm-hmm. we've heard keys and strings on Fear Factory before, it's a little bit different on this one. You know, and then you have like some djenty mashuga type sections as well. You know, given that you've been doing this for, you know, over 30 years now, how important is it for you to like work in those new ideas and keep it fresh for yourself versus trying not to alienate, you know, the Fear Factory fans from 30 years ago?
Good question. You know, I, like I said before, every record that I approach, I try to approach a little differently. I think one of the things that really stood out to me on this record was the fact that we had like four different keyboard players. So we had Igor. He was in a band called Yes from like the 80s, the 90s into the 2000s. He was in the band for a long time, and he's an amazing, talented musician. And I can't say his last name, Kreshkov. He's a Russian guy. So, and he's super talented. He produced Bert's vocals, and he also did some keyboards on the album. One of them being the song Recode. He did some huge orchestral pieces on that song that just made it sound like a movie soundtrack. So, you know, that really stood out, something very different for me. And then we had a guy named Giuseppe Bassi. He's an Italian guy, kind of like an unknown guy that Logan Mater tipped me to this guy. And he's super talented, super modern. You know, he did songs like Monolith and a few other tracks. Then we had Max Caron, who is my guitar tech. He is a great keyboard player, right? And so he added some of his elements too, like on Disruptor, that was his synth line in the chorus. You know, there's some talented guys on this record. We also had, Damien Reynaud, who's also a very talented drummer, and he's also a very talented keyboard player as well. You know, he could write those simple synth lines that just stick out, you know, and he was really good at that. And I just thought that having all those different elements and different guys contributing some, you know, different ideas and different sounds and soundscapes and, you know, some electronic stuff, you know, doing all that stuff just, I think, really made the record stand out.
You have been doing that since day one, you know, I mean, yeah. Incorporating industrial and techno parts and really just embracing the digital age way before it was a thing, you know? Like, how did you get started? Like, what's your background in like the, you know, the techno / industrial area? Was it Godflesh, or was it like KMFDM? Was it something really far off that we don't know about?
Well, I think probably the first stuff I heard back in the 80s was, you know, obviously Ministry, right? That opened my eyes to a lot of different types of stuff. And then of course it goes to KMFDM, Leibach, you know, Beat Beat Manifesto, which is kind of more of the dancier stuff. And then obviously early Prodigy, which was also in the late 80s as well. But then of course, when I heard Godflesh, they were kind of bridging the gap between those two, you know, the electronic element and the fucking brutal, just crushing riffs. That was probably the one where that band was probably the band that me and Bert both connected on. That was when we started our friendship, just from the discovering of Godflesh. And of course, you know, I grew up metalhead when I was a kid, first hearing AC/DC, Black Sabbath, and then it progressed from there to the Iron Maidens and Def Leppards and Motley Crue. And then you hear the first, you know, Metallica and then Exodus and Slayer and all that stuff, and just progressively got more heavier and more brutal, you know? So I think, like, of course, my riffing style pretty much was influenced by that, you know, and every guitar player gave me something different. You know, all those influences melted me who I was. But one of the main things was when I was starting Fear Factory, I was like, okay, I got this thrash metal vibe, kind of, you know, really fast picking stuff with patterns and things like that. But I was like, I wanted to copy the machine. I wanted to copy a sampler, right? Because we didn't, back in 1990, we didn't have samplers, right? We couldn't afford that, right? So I was like, well, how do I copy the guitar like that? Because, you know, like there's been a lot of industrial bands, when they sample a guitar riff, you can actually hear the loop. A song called South by Resistor, which was on D-Manufacture. That was me trying to really copy the machine. And the riff goes, so it sounded like a sampled riff. And people, when the record came out, people actually thought it was a sampled riff. But I go, no, that's just me learning the stop, start vibe back then, right? And then, like, you know, in early on in our career, when I first heard Metallica do the midsection of One, I was like, damn, why can't they do that more? Why isn't there more bands doing that? Why isn't there, like, I'm like, okay, well, then when I do Fear Factory, I'm going to, like, do that. And that's kind of like what I based the whole musical style, just stop, start, drums, sync, kick drums syncopated with, you know, the guitar riff. And so that was the first stuff that we started writing. You know, it became very much a style, and it's very much in music today.
Yeah.
You know, with bands like Meshuggah, which a million other bands that they influence as well. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. And from what I understand, I just want to also get this right, but you are now the sole owner of the Fear Factory brand and name, right?
Correct.
Okay. And it's, you know, I know it's been a really long journey you know, you rightfully own Fear Factory and have a new album out. I feel it must be liberating and even exciting for what the future might hold, right?
Definitely very liberating, because it's like, everything, like all this stuff, like, was all this worth it? Everything you went through. And yes, hell yeah, it's worth it. Because look, you get a new Fear Factory record, you know, and you're going to get future Fear Factory records. And I want to be able to carry the tradition of what I started. Everything that I just explained to you of how the music started, I'm going to carry that into the future. Sure, everybody's asking me, hey, what's going to happen with vocals? You know, because Burton, you know, departed the band, and I'm very excited about what's to come. I've discovered new talent before, right? I think I have a great track record when it comes to music, writing music. I've done a lot of stuff. I've done a lot of music, a lot of different projects, and everything that I always bring, it's always the metal. I always bring it. Whether it's Brujeria, Asesino, Roadrunner All-Stars, Divine Heresy Records, and of course, all the Fear Factory records. So I am going to continue that tradition. And I never lost, and I never forgot where I came from. I believe in myself. I believe in what I do. And I believe that what I'm going to bring in the future is going to be just as sick as what you hear now.
I understand that you've narrowed down a vocalist who's going to be working with you moving forward. Have you officially made a decision on Burton's replacement yet?
Well, I'll put it this way. It's going to be an announcement, and it's probably going to be it's not going to be announced now. You know, we want to mainly focus on this new record. We have a new single coming out this Friday. It's called Fuel Injected Suicide Machine, which I know you heard the track.
Yep.
And that song is based off of Mad Max, the Knight Rider. There's a character in the movie Mad Max called the Knight Rider, and the song is based off of him. And he says in the movie, I'm the Knight Rider, the fuel injected suicide machine. And when Bert told me that was going to be the name of the song, I was like, how do I envision, like, that guy in that car? What kind of riff would I write? Because a lot of times when we write music, it's visual. For me, it's visual, right? It's a visual, it's a feeling, you know, it's a vibe. It's an undeniable feeling sometimes. Like, it's just there. Like, it's something that's very passionate in you that needs to come out, right? So when I picture that song, and I know the movie, I know that scene in the movie, I was like, okay, what is a car? How do I make my guitar sound like a car for that song? So it's So that's kind of like how I envisioned an engine, a hot rod engine going, and it came out killer. And so that's going to be our single, and that's what we want to concentrate so on. So now about announcing a new singer, that's not going to come anytime soon. We're going to be very patient about that, very conscious, and it'll be a big announcement. I do want to maybe do, this is just off the top of my head, maybe do a live stream where we introduce him and then maybe be in a rehearsal studio and just, you know, belt out a few songs so you can hear this person singing.
This record, Aggression Continuum, is being labeled as the band's 10th record. Mm-hmm. In my opinion, there's two albums I don't really care for. I think you could figure out which ones. It made me think about how everyone has a different, you know, a preference of Fear Factory record or opinion on how to rank them. But I actually would love to know, you know, your opinion.
Well, my opinion is that I recognize them as Fear Factory records because they were Fear Factory records. Just because I wasn't there doesn't make them not Fear Factory records. So I recognize them as Fear Factory records and I add them to the catalog. And that's why I say 10th studio album, because on the cover of the new album, Aggression Continuum, has an automaton, and on the automaton, he has his legs open to kind of form an X, which is a Roman numeral 10. And so I wanted that to represent our 10th record. And I also wanted it to represent the present. Now, if you look at the automaton on the bottom right F, on the bottom, you could see a serial number, and the serial number says FF103190. That's the date that we started. So that was the birth of the machine. Aggression Continuum means, you know, to continue the aggression, right? And so that's like the past, present, and the future. That's what that record, that's what that album cover represents.
Yeah, I like it. A lot of symbolism there.
A lot of symbolism there, yes. And then at the very end of the record, you hear the speech, Fear is the Mind Killer speech from the movie Dune. And one of the lines says, when the fear is gone, only I remain. And that's pretty much representing like me being the last sole survivor of the band and moving forward and not fearing moving forward.
Is it safe to say that now that you are, you know, immersed in Fear Factory and you own, you know, the sole survivor and you own it and everything, is this going to be your number one? Like, are you going to be able to or want to do other projects, or is it just going to be Fear Factory from here on out?
Well, from day one, I've immersed myself into Fear Factory, and it's been my number one every time I've been in the band. And I try to focus mainly on Fear Factory. Now it's mainly Fear Factory, but of course, I have other bands like Asesino. We got to put out a third record. I've been working on it for the past 10 years. Just, you know, trying to find the time to finish it, to be honest with you. And now that Tony Campos is back in Static X, you know, his time is pretty much occupied because, you know, he owns all that. So yeah, and he's really immersed into that. So it's going to be weird because we're going to be trying to, he's going to be trying to divide his time between Fear Factory and Static X.
I was going to say, yeah, I could see a Static X Fear Factory thing in the future, you know?
Well, it's funny you say that. Just remember those words that you said. Right. So when we tour together, obviously that's going to work out. But when we're not touring together and he's out with Static X and we're out with Fear Factory, I already talked to Matt DeVries, and he's been in the band during the Industrialist tour. He was in the band for a little while, so he'll be filling in for Tony. Yeah, so I'm hoping that I get to finally finish this Asesino record, because there's so much stuff in the future coming out with Fear Factory. And hopefully eventually I'll be able to get back to do a Divine Heresy record.
Wow. Well, you definitely keep yourself busy, man. Fear Factory to me will forever be not only pioneers, but constant innovators, you know, in the metal genre. First band I can think of to push, you know, the singing, screaming, first to popularize more strings and lower tunings, collaborating with artists, you know, out of outside genres like Rhys Fulberg, Gary Numan, changing the sound of fucking records as we know it. You know, there's just an endless list of bands that I think owe you a debt of gratitude in their sound. That said, how do you feel about the new generation of, you know, metal bands today?
I love the new generation of bands that are coming out, like, you know, bands like Spirit Box and numerous other bands like that, even Code Orange, who were bringing in, you know, a hardcore with an industrial vibe to it, and, you know, being very creative. I love that stuff. And I know that they recognize that Fear Factory was an influence on them, because they've been wearing Fear Factory shirts on stage and stuff like that. And they've reached out to me. And, you know, there was something interesting that happened to me when I was in 2004, when I went to Dimebag Darrell's funeral. You know, I was talking to Zach Wilde, and Zach Wilde came up to me and said, "Hey, Dimebag left this torch for us. It is up to us to pass that torch." So what he's trying to say is that Dimebag left this body of music and this influence for us to pass on to next generations. And I believe that. And I think that's part of being successful, that you're able to influence somebody else to take up guitar, drums, sticks, you know, keyboards, vocals, you know, you're able to influence somebody else to go and create something new. And I think that's the beauty of passing on this torch.
Dude, thank you so much for talking to us. Aggression Continuum, it's coming out. It's fucking amazing. It's the next chapter of Fear Factory, and we have plenty of more to look forward to. Dino, have a great time. And yeah, we'll see you hopefully out in the road soon, I guess, you know?
Next year for sure, 100% for sure. Also, one last word. If you want to know anything about the band, go to fearfactory.com. There you can pre-order the new album, because it comes out June 18th. New single comes out May 14th. It's called Fuel Injected Suicide Machine. Check that out wherever you stream music. Just go there to fearfactory.com, because you can buy cassettes. You could buy vinyl. You can buy the CDs, the merchandise. Plus, we're doing a lot of giveaways as well. We're giving away my Protone pedal. It's an overdrive pedal, so you can pre-save or pre-add the album, and you can win that. You can also win this beautiful seven-string Ormsby guitar. It's a signature guitar. So when you go and pre-save the album, you know, you get your chance to win that stuff. So go to fearfactory.com. Thank you for your time, man. I appreciate it.
Absolutely.
Thanks, Frank.